examples might begin with, at that time, there were people present who told Jesus about the 9 people murdered in Kalamazoo and Heston in the past week, or about the 16 people who were injured in those shootings. And we know that guns didn't fire themselves. They were fired by 2 men who deliberately took the lives of others, just like Pilate took the lives of those Galileans. But when told about this situation, Jesus would have asked his hearers, do you think that those people who were killed were worse sinners than any other Americans? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will die too. Maybe not in the same way, but you will surely die. So to a modern version of the gospel might have told about that 600-foot-tall construction crane that came crashing down on a building and pedestrians and parked cars in Manhattan at the earlier part of this month and killed a man on his way to work. And Jesus again would have said, do you think that the man who was killed on his way to work was any worse sinner than all the other people who live and work in the Big Apple? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will also die. Accidents and tragedies happen every day. Sadly, they are a part of our life. And the gospel, Jesus would say pretty much that these people's lives were snuffed out with little warning and for no apparent reason. These people did nothing wrong except being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Life is precarious. Life is risky business. It's like that song that a group called Sweet Honey in the Rock sing. Can't no one know at sunrise how this day is going to end. Can't no one know at sunset if the next day will begin. And Martin Luther's amen to that would have been, this is most certainly true. Now, Jesus could have used these 2 examples to defend God, because sometimes people blame God when these kind of events happen, thinking that if God had been present, these things wouldn't have happened. But we know that God isn't some kind of manager or fix-it person in the sky. God isn't like an absentee landlord. God expects us to be good stewards of what we've been given and good responders when things go wrong. So instead of defending God, Jesus implies that bad things happen, but that doesn't mean that God is punishing us. Bad things just happen. Sin doesn't make massacres and other tragedies come. They just come. At the same time, though, because life is so fragile and so fleeting, we shouldn't think that we can live completely carefree, eating, drinking, and being married, never giving any thought to the future. I mean, just because we're healthy, wealthy, or wise today doesn't mean that somehow we are more favored by God than anybody else. Jesus' point is not that we live in fear that bad things will happen, either to bad or good people, because they will. But Jesus' illustrations are given to encourage his followers to turn to God. Because the last day is coming. Not just our last day as individuals, but there will be a judgment day. We say it every Sunday in the Creed. On the third day, he rose again, he ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. There will be a judgment day, and it's on the horizon, whether it's near or far, far away, we don't know. But Jesus wants us to turn to God, who longs to bring us close to God's heart and to save us. And so to bring home this talking about calamities, Jesus tells his listeners a parable about an unfruitful fig tree. I myself do not like figs. And even as a kid, I would much rather have eaten Jesus' point, even if he wasn't talking about Nabisco cookies 2,000 years ago, was about an unfruitful fig tree. This parable probably would have been familiar to Jesus' listeners because there were lots of stories circulating in other cultures about unfruitful trees. But what makes Jesus' story different is that while the possibility of judgment is there, there's an even greater possibility of mercy. Man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on the tree and found none. So the owner said to the gardener, "Look, for 3 years I have been coming looking for fruit on this tree, and I still find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasted soil?" But the gardener, that blessed gardener, says, "Sir, just give it one more year. Let me dig around it, put some manure on it, and if it grows fruit, well and good. And if not, in a year, you can cut it down." Isn't this a real cliffhanger? Don't you want to know what happens to the fruit tree? Well, some digger deeping and some digger deeping. How about that? I'm glad you caught that. Well, some deeper digging and putting some good manure around the base of that tree, save it from the axe and the compost pile. What is going to make this tree produce fruit? What's going to help it turn around? Well, the second or the third or the fourth or the 100th chance that the gardener has asked for finally be effective? Well, I don't know about you, but these are the kinds of questions that run through my mind because honestly, I don't know what I would do if I didn't trust that the God who named and claimed us in our baptism wasn't a God of second chances. How many times have you and I messed up and asked for a second or a third or a 100th chance? How many limps? Well, I go through intending to do X or Y, and I always end up doing the Z that I don't want to do. How many times have I said and done those things that make me wonder if somebody were looking at me, they would ask, what kind of Christian is she? This would be especially noticeable when I'm in the car, driving in the left-hand lane, behind people that drive very slow. The truth is that life is fraught with frustrations and failures of all kinds, and life is so very fragile. Every single one of us is vulnerable to misfortune, to injustice, to sickness, suffering. But Jesus wants to know what that great poet Mary Oliver asks. Tell me, what is it